a colorless, carbonated, caffeine-free, lemon and lime flavored soft drink created by the Coca-Cola Company. Seems harmless, doesn't it? Sold in 190 countries and a profit of $3.7 billion in sales with a brand value of $6.2 billion according to Forbes.com as of May 2015. So what's the story behind this one?
Hey, mister. Can I trade in a 7-Up for a Sprite?
Gee, I don't know. Something the matter?
Yeah, Sprite tastes better than 7-Up.
Come on.
Really, Sprite even beat 7-Up in a taste test.
I always thought they were the same.
Nah, Sprite's the one with more in it, and more people chose that green one to taste. Here, try it.
Kid, you just made a sale.
Let's dig in. The Sprite flavor was first developed in West Germany in 1959 as Fanta Clear Zitron, or Clear Lemon Fanta. It was later released in the US as Sprite in 1961. The word Sprite actually comes from Latin spiritus, meaning spirit, used to describe elves and fairies in European folklore. See any resemblance here?
That's what caught my curiosity. The fact that you would name a drink Spirit, I had to figure out if there was something more sinister behind this.
For those who don't already know, this is Sprite Boy. Sprite Boy was actually created before Sprite as a brand image for Sprite's owner, the Coca-Cola Company. So Sprite's owned by the Coca-Cola Company? This is all making sense now. Let's get a quick history lesson on Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola was invented in 1886 by a pharmacist by the name of John Stith Pemberton in Columbus, Georgia. In April 1865, he took a wound to the chest during the Battle of Columbus and became heavily addicted to morphine as a result of the pain. He began to seek a cure for his addiction in 1866. He experimented with coca wines, and soon created Pemberton's French wine coca. Historian Phil Mooney stated that there were some concerns on this world-famous soda, which were to include drug addiction, alcoholism, depression, neurasthenia, and highly strung southern women. By 1886, he was forced to create a non-alcoholic beverage. Pemberton then joined forces with a Willis E. Venable, who owned a drugstore in Atlanta, to create a new product. Pemberton decided to sell it as a fountain drink as opposed to a medicine. So, was it actually a medicine?
Lots of people think it's a myth, but it's true that Coca-Cola started out with cocaine as an active ingredient. Cocaine was first used as a medicine that was administered to children and even pregnant women. They didn't know what we know about cocaine, and so they thought it was perfect to put in wine. And yes, even beverages like Coca-Cola.
Now, my initial investigation was to only include Sprite. But after revealing certain facts, it soon shifted to the creation of soda itself. Now, Pemberton being a physician, yet creating a drink so bad for your health that on a regular consumption over a period of time would lead you right back to a physician's office, just wouldn't sit right with me. All praises to the Most High God. After reading and reading, the connection became evident. Pemberton was a part of the medical revolution. This is where it gets weird.
What drugs do to our frontal lobe and remember that the caduceus was used by Mercury to put people into a deep sleep and to control both the living and the dead, then we can see this control that is wielded over the human mind and body, its connection with drug medication, and the dangerous condition that this has placed our society in.
See, John Pemberton also went to a medical reform school in Georgia, Macomb. At the age of 19, he was licensed to practice on Thomsonian and botanical principles. This is important due to the fact that by the early 16th century, broader trends in Renaissance culture, particularly humanism, had begun to replace the university-based medical learning. Humanists began to scrutinize classical texts, which led to multiple changes and even some attempts to amend the knowledge of the ancients. A gradual increase of perception of value based on investigations in which verifiable observation or experience rather than theory or logic about the natural world. The addition of new faculties of anatomy and botany at multiple universities were established. To sum it up, the intellectuals didn't want to believe in the Word of God. They wanted scientific explanation to explain away the biblical beliefs and replace it with their new doctrines.
For more than 1,500 years, Christians saw the Bible as the primary source of knowledge. But in the 17th century, a new movement emerged that challenged the Christian view of the world. The Scientific Revolution.
It was a time when people were looking towards a new way of thinking about the world.
During the Renaissance, the rising power of science forced the Catholic Church to silence rebellious scientists. By the 19th century, the Enlightenment had given rise to a new generation of scientists who pushed Christianity into retreat.
Darwin removed the main argument for God's existence.
Now, also during this time, the classical authors, or as they called them, classical thinkers like Hippocrates, Galen, Aristotle, still held their positions as important authorities through the 17th century. During this time, a new medical theory was put into play based on alchemical principles, led mainly by a Swiss doctor by the name of Paracelsus, who in several aspects pioneered the medical revolution.
The central dedication of Paracelsus was always to alchemy. His other interests, which were very numerous, but let's say primarily medicine and various other interests, all centered around alchemy.
But these classical thinkers, or philosophers, weren't the originators of this new medical theory.
It's actually documented that classical Greek thinkers traveled to Egypt to get more knowledge. Thales, Hippocrates, Socrates, Plato, and Pythagoras all traveled to study at temple universities, Waset and Ipet Aissou. The Kemetic education was a 40-year program, and no Greek thinker or philosopher had ever completed this program. But what caught my eye is Hippocrates was known as father of medicine. He learned about disease from previous explorations of Imhotep, who in the late 27th century BC was an Egyptian chancellor who today is referred to as a poet, a judge, a scribe, an astronomer, an astrologer, a magician, and a physician.
Now, we seem to have a common denominator here with the physicians. They all started out as scientists, or as in the ancient times, like Imhotep, magicians. Now, magicians are mentioned in the Bible in Exodus, for example, with Pharaoh and Moses. Most High made an example out of Pharaoh and his magicians. Magicians used a method of sorcery or enchanting, which brings me to the term pharmakia. Pharmakia, by the Strong's Concordance, is the use or administering of drugs, poisoning, sorcery, and magical arts. Pharmacy or pharmaceutical stems from pharmakia, and in the New Testament, sorcery is translated to pharmakia. Now, is this modern-day sorcery or enchanting by magicians, or shall we say, scientists?
This was the same tactic used by witches to disguise their poisonous potions. What we render a witch, according to our modern notions of witchcraft, Philo and Josephus understood of a poisoner, or of one who attempted by secret and unlawful drugs or philtra to take away the senses or the lives of men. In the fairy tales, we have mental pictures of witches stirring their potion and throwing in all kinds of terrible ingredients. This practice has come down to us today from Egyptian medicine and paganism to the modern pharmaceutical and vaccine industry, as illustrated in this 1899 picture taken from a university yearbook. The ancient Egyptian medicines were made out of animal products as well as toxic materials apart from natural ingredients commonly found in the country. Animal parts sometimes included brain, liver, or even bile, which was utilized as magical remedies and worked as a magical potion to cure the patient. Toxic minerals like arsenic or copper, along with lead, when used with caution by an experienced physician and were considered very effective in curing different ailments. To judge from the variety of recipes in medical text, any medication would involve fairly revolting ingredients. Dung from various animals, fat from cats, fly droppings, and even cooked mice are just a small selection of the range of remedies that the Egyptian doctor could recommend as treatment. Egyptians were also known to use crocodile dung in their medications. Now, while this sounds disgusting to us, modern medicine is really no different from these ancient practices, except for the fact that recently some ingredients have been compounded synthetically instead of using the original source. Some have been discontinued due, ironically, to toxic side effects. Some, however, are still in use. Still others are being tested for possible future use. Doctors go to great lengths to disguise the fact that they are practicing a black art rather than a science. The medical profession has created a pseudoscience of mammoth proportions, and today's doctors rely on a vast variety of instruments and tests and pieces of equipment with which to explain and dignify their interventions.
So these philosophers only reintroduced the practice of medicine from ancient Egypt. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Now we are told to avoid these philosophers and their science. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called. Okay, vain, having an excessively high pride in one's appearance, achievements, and abilities. Profane, devoted to that which is not sacred or biblical, secular rather than religious. As you can see, if you didn't already know, ancient Egypt was well known for alchemy, which I'm sure these philosophers sought after the most.
Alchemy is science, science is medicine.
Alchemy is a chemical science and speculative philosophy aiming to achieve the transmutation of the base metals into gold, the discovery of a universal cure for disease, and the discovery of a means of indefinitely prolonging life. Now, I know it seems as if we may have got way off topic here, but the creation of soda water was created by Joseph Priestley by dripping sulfuric acid onto chalk to produce a gas. This was then dissolved into an agitated bowl of water. Does this sound like alchemy or science to you?
Okay, so we have John Pemberton, the creator of Coca-Cola, who's a pharmacist and a chemist. Now we have Joseph Priestley, who's not only the creator of soda water itself, but he's also a natural philosopher and a chemist. But most importantly, a member of the Lunar Society.
In Birmingham, there was one group of outstanding thinkers, including doctors, who would become the intellectual powerhouse of the Industrial Revolution. They were called the Lunar Society.
This is Soho House, the home of local manufacturer Matthew Bolton. He'd invited friends here for convivial evenings, but these evenings were not only evenings of pleasure, but also very serious intent. When food was over, the chums would sit around the table discussing ways in which to change the world, and the topics embraced were many indeed. They would talk about manufacturing, commerce, radical politics, the arts, and of course, science.
Medicine, science, and alchemy, it all stems back together.
Jesus, our priest and physician, gave the orders for health to the Israelites when he brought them out of Egypt. He told them, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. Diseases found among the wealthy mummies of Egypt include heart disease, cancers, smallpox, tuberculosis, arthritis, bone disease, leprosy, eye diseases, trichinosis, and parasitic infections. Queen Hatshepsut suffered from arthritis, diabetes, and bad teeth, and is believed to have died of bone cancer. God's laws were to keep the Israelites from getting these diseases. It is interesting to note that even though there were infectious diseases, nowhere did God mention vaccinations or pharmaceuticals as the remedy.
one water. How many can water? Pure water. You see, one minute you see, never not dead. Water, not poison. No, see, Israel product. Israel, 7-Up, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, all item. Israel, poison have. You see, finish. All my friends, Israel, any product, slow poison have. Any drinking item, Pepsi, Coca-Cola, 7-Up, another one, any product, Israel, slow poison have, you not understand. After 1 year, 5 years, finish.
In 2004, Coca-Cola released a new brand of pure bottled water called Dasani to the UK, which was said to have a highly sophisticated purification process. This turned out to be reverse osmosis, an extremely common process used in most domestic water purification units. As if it wasn't bad enough to mark up tap water up to $1.50 per half litre, it was also revealed that the water contained 10 micrograms per litre of the carcinogenic chemical bromate.
And yes, ladies and gentlemen, just like in the What Are You Really Listening To video, Who Do Entertainers Really Work For video, the Porn's Hidden Agenda video, the Bank Cartel video, the Dangers of Facebook video, the Invisible Enemy video.
Guess who's financing the slow takeover this time? You got it.
And the balance of medical power remained equal until the turn of the century. Then new medical treatments emerged that were potentially very profitable. The AMA joined with strong financial forces to transform medicine into an industry. The fortunes of Carnegie, Morgan, and Rockefeller.
Carnegie, Morgan, and Rockefeller
financed surgery, radiation, and synthetic drugs. They were to become the economic foundations of the new medical economy.
Modern allopathic medicine, just like its counterpart in Egypt, restricts the knowledge of disease and its treatments to the medical professionals and creates a form of hierarchy. Hieratic scripts talk of a hierarchy of medical care, starting with ancient Egyptian words meaning the ordinary doctor, overseer of doctors, chief of doctors, and finally, inspector of doctors. The common man is made to believe that he cannot understand how disease works or how to treat himself, and that he should just trust his body to the doctor's wisdom. Unless we put medical freedom into the Constitution, the time will come when medicine will organize into an undercover dictatorship. To restrict the art of healing to one class of men and deny equal privilege to others will be to constitute the Bastille of medical science. All such laws are un-American and despotic and have no place in a republic. The Constitution of the Republic should make a special privilege for medical freedom as well as for religious freedom.
As we did more research, we started to find that unholy grip that the pharmaceutical companies have got on the media and governments also, with their very powerful lobbying of governments around the world, that a lot of this information is suppressed, and many of your listeners may know that. I mean, it's probably a tale in itself to talk about how the media is manipulated and how this information is kept from the public. And it's only through shows like yours that the general public can start to learn the truth about what's going off in many fields, not just health.
Not sure about you, but soda sure resembles a bubbling witch's potion to me. But seriously, the soft drink and flavoring company's creators and founders seem to all be associated with sorcery in some sort of fashion. Being that this medical monster was created, it had to be fed. Fed meaning a new healthcare system needs patients to profit. No patients, no business. No money in healing, but plenty money in the sickness due to the continuous doctor visits. So were these philosophers in groups like the Lunar Society discussing and inventing ways to fill the seats of the new Rockefeller AMA-approved physicians?
Examinations, second opinions, medications, new tests, surgical operations, support therapies, and follow-up checks. They find themselves at the complete mercy of the disease. While in that tunnel, each patient feeds an immense medical apparatus that employs hundreds of thousands of people and generates millions and millions of dollars for the medical and pharmaceutical industries. From research laboratories to medical schools, from prevention clinics to worldwide drug sales. Today, the cancer medical apparatus is so large and expensive that it needs its patients in order to survive just as much as the patients need the apparatus. To sum it all up, the pharmaceutical industry first gained control of the teaching system. Then it gave the AMA the power to exclude all other doctors from practicing. Then it took over the entire drug testing process, while heavily influencing the medical publications that reviewed those drugs. And finally, Big Pharma extended its control over the federal entity that is supposed to verify those drugs' safety and efficacy.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Look at your monster drink closely. There's a gap right here in the letter M.
Okay.
It's not connected.
No.
So we go into Hebrew. The letter Vav is also a number 6. It's got a short top and a long tail.
Okay.
A short top and a long tail.
Okay.
You could have here your 666 on the can.
Okay.
But my interest is the word monster. What do you see in the O?
It looks like a cross.
There's a cross. What has Christ got to do with an energy drink, let alone the name Monster? So I thought, well, maybe it's a Christian company.
Mm-hmm.
On the front of the can, it says BFC. Do you know what that stands for?
No.
That's the F word, big can.
Uh-huh.
In fact, it's written on the side of the can. So
can I get a look?
Yep. It's written on the third line down, biggest effing can we could find.
That's
so we
disgusting.
Know that that is the F word.
Uh-huh.
Now, if you're not familiar with the term MILF, it's an acronym.
Okay.
MILF.
Uh-huh.
It means a mother I'd like to.
Yeah.
That is on the box. MILFs, dig it, and you will too.
That's disgusting.
That breaks two commandments right there. This is not a Christian company at all. So why would the cross be on the can? Here is the message. Antichrist. 666 in Hebrew. And then the Bible talks about the beast in Revelation. And look at Monster's ad. That is their statement. Unleash the beast. We see these M's everywhere. Hats, t-shirts, bumper stickers. Is there another agenda? If God can use people and products, so can Satan.
Yeah.
And even if we don't look at the M as an issue, let's just say that's not even there. You cannot deny that that is a cross. And what is witchcraft? It's when the cross goes upside down. How much blasphemy can you do? Drinking from a monster drink. Call yourself a
Christian. Pay attention. This is how the devil gets in. Thank you very much, man.
Odd Topic. Don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button, baby.